Hello everybody and welcome to another episode of Stable Diffusion for Professional Creatives. Today we'll be taking a look at how to inpaint with basically any model really, be it Flux, SDXL, or whichever model you want. I am going to show you two different methods that I use. A simpler one, which is this one, which is demonstrated on both SDXL here in the center and Flux here on the right. And one that is a bit more complex, but achieves a bit more resolution. Again, demonstrated on both SDXL here in the center and Flux here on the right. I'm not going to show inpainting on 1.5, mostly because I haven't been using that much lately, but it still works. You just need a 1.5 model with inpainting capabilities. And on SD3, 3.5, but that's just because we don't have control nets available for 3.5 yet, at least at the time of recording this. What's important is that the same tools and the same concepts basically will apply to basically any model with inpainting capabilities. And that's because, well, really, this is as simple as it gets. I've seen a ton of crazy inpainting workflows out there with a ton of nodes and math and overall a ton of stuff going on, but this setup is my basically go-to setup every single time I have to inpaint something. Same as always, you will be able to find all the models you need as well as custom nodes and workflows in the description below, where you can also find timestamps if you want to jump ahead. So let's take a look at what's going on here. Well, at the core we have an input image, and here I am resizing it just to prepare it for Flux dimensions, something that is not necessary on SDXL, but since I am working with both, might as well do it in the beginning. And what I'm doing is just rounding the width and height to the nearest multiple of 8, and then resizing the image. That's the easiest way that I've found to get a correct resizing every single time, basically. There might be nodes that do exactly this, but by now it's just second nature to me. Every time I have to work with Flux, I just round the width and height to the nearest multiple of 8. Then in both of these workflows, the one for the SDXL and Flux, which are the same, they are quite literally the same, there are a couple of things that are happening. Let's go in order of importance. The most important thing that I am doing, and that is something that I struggled with a ton when I started out using inpainting techniques, is using a control net. Now, out there's a ton of people who swear by not using a control net at all when inpainting. I disagree, and that's because I think that when you are not using a control net, you are basically at the mercy of whatever the model's understanding out of the request you're making. Whereas with a control net, even at a low strength, you are guiding the model through the process, and that achieves more consistent results, at least in my experience. I might just be very bad at not using control nets. So in this case, I am using Adapt Control Net. You can see here the preview of the preprocessor that I'm using. And for SDXL, I am using the Control Net Depth SDXL Bike Sensor at a strength of 0.4 all the way from the first step to the last. And I'm extracting the depth map with Depth Anything V2 relative. Another important thing that is happening is that I'm using differential diffusion. Now it's wild to me how differential diffusion is not that well known in the community. It's a lifesaver when you are using masks. What differential diffusion does, and here's the paper if you want to read it, is giving each pixel its strength based on the proximity to the black and white borders of a map. And without it, you get way worse results out of inpainting workflows. It works with basically any model out there. It works with SDXL, with 1.5, with Flux, and it's just one tiny node that you append in the middle of the model pipeline. Another thing that I'm doing is using a grow mask with blur node that lets me expand and blur a bit of the mask that I am drawing inside the mask editor. If you're using custom masks, finely tuned, on, for example, Photoshop, then you might not want to use it. But most of the time, I quite like it. And the last thing that I am doing is using inpaint model conditioning. Now, what this node does is basically two nodes into one. The theory behind inpainting is that you're basically asking for a VA encode node and a set latent noise mask node. What this does, it's basically injecting noise where the mask is into the latent. So instead of using two nodes, we can just use the inpaint model conditioning node. The same thing happens over here for Flux. We are using the Union Pro control net. And since it's a Union control net, we have to select the kind of control net we want to use, in this case, Stepped. We are using differential diffusion. We are growing the mask with blur, and then we are using inpaint model conditioning. As you can see, both results are quite good. Obviously, the Flux version is better. It's a better model than the SDXL, but well, that's a given. But as you can see, as we keep on generating And by the way, these results are not cherry-picked. They are literally the first results that I'm getting every time I hit Q prompt. The results are quite good and quite consistent as well. I haven't got a single bad image out of this. Now, let's disable the nodes that I'm using one by one and see why they're important. Let's go in reverse order of importance. So first, let's disable the growth mask with blur node. As you can see, the falloff between the inpainted area and the non-inpainted area is much harsher. And as such, the generation has much less leeway in order to self-correct. Here in the SDXL version, you can see that there is this white area where the mask ends. And here in the Flux version, you can see that there's an eye that gets transposed a bit too much to the right. And that's just by disabling the blur. So let's try re-enabling it. And this time, let's disable differential diffusion. And let's go again. And as you can see, once again, the falloff between the mask and the non-masked area is much harsher, and the generation is struggling to make sense of the areas in between the mask and the non-masked area. And that's in both models. You can see this blurry area here in the SDXL version, as well as these horrible tiny extra fingers that come out of the generation. And here in the Flux version, you can see that there's this mass of hair happening on top of the flowers. Now, let's try re-enabling differential diffusion and disabling control net. And let's go. And as you can see, the generations are much more random. It's not really following any rhyme or reason, at least in the SDXL version, where it's basically in painting whatever I asked for, so in this case, red flowers, without caring about the underlying image. Whereas with Flux, it's trying a bit more, but still it's struggling a lot to make sense of it. The overall quality of the image is pretty bad. Now, of course, while differential diffusion doesn't have any kind of parameter, and grow mask with blur is doing very, very little, at least in the sense of how parameters are chosen. In this case, I'm just expanding the mask by 20 pixels and blurring it by 20. That's basically random inputs. You can input basically whatever, as long as it makes sense for your mask. Control net strength parameter requires a bit more finesse. Let's take a look at the depth map in order to understand what I mean by that. Here in the depth map, you can see what was going on in the original image. This girl was holding some very tiny flowers, and the depth map is picking that up. Now, I don't want the exact same kind of flowers. I don't want the exact same size of those flowers. So I need to adjust the control net in a way that gives the model enough understanding of the general depth, but without forcing the original size of the flowers that are present in the input image. Now, in this case, I'm going with 0.4. In this example here, I went with 0.3 strength, for example, and it still works quite nicely, but it's less consistent. In this example, and I'm not cherry picking, you can see that the hands are quite horrible in both cases, and your overall success rate gets lower. But on the other hand, if we push the strength a bit too high, for example 0.8, you can see how the inpainting stops doing basically anything in both cases, and that's because the underlying depth is too strong for the model to do anything really. So it's a fine balance between finding a correct strength that still applies the overall shape of what's underneath the inpainting, but not too high as not to render the effort of inpainting basically useless. Now, there's two things to remember. One is that not all control nets and models are created equal. Different models, for example, SDXL and Flux, and different control nets, for example, the sensor control nets for SDXL and the control net union for Flux, may require different strengths, even if you're trying to do the same thing. And the second one is that I personally like going as low as possible in terms of strength while still getting a high enough success rate. More so if what I'm working on is automatable and should be automated. Now, this is of course not the case because we are working on one image only, but think of automatable tasks. You want a high enough success rate, but you don't want to overfit the strength on a single image. You want that strength to work with most of the images you have. Now, there's a thing that we haven't thought about yet, and that is that both these models are very similar in terms of optimal resolution. But we are not in painting at optimal resolution. We are in painting over a small area that is just a part of the image. Now, how do we fix that? Well, we can fix that by using the second workflow that I am providing, which is basically the same. In this top part, we have SDXL here in the center and Flux here on the right. And here at the bottom, we have the same logic applied to both of them. So this one is the same as this one, basically. And what we are doing here is just cropping the mask and the image automatically based on the mask bounding box. As you can see here, I am cropping both the original image and the mask based on the mask's bounding box. And then I am using these two, the resulting image and the mask, upscaled to 1 megapixel as the sources for the inpaint model conditioning node. We can see the resulting inpainted image here, and this is 1 megapixel, which then gets blended back into the original image by targeting the previous bounding box. And we can see the result here. It does sound a little bit complicated, so let's take a look at it in Photoshop. For example, we have this original image with the mask applied. What the auto cropping logic does is it selects an area around the mask, the bounding box, it separates it, and it gets something like this. But this is still less than 1 megapixel, less than the optimal resolution. So what it then does, it just resizes it to the optimal resolution. And once it's done, we get an image that is 1 megapixel, and it scales it back at its original size, and then it blends it back where it belongs, on top of the original image. It sounds complex, but it's very easy. And as we can see here, the overall quality of the inpainting in terms of resolution is much better, both in the SDXL version and the Flux version. And as we keep on generating, we keep on getting good consistent results. And even if we wanted to change something else, for example the sweater, let's turn it green for example. And for this one, we might want to up the control net a bit, just to help the model get a better understanding of the sweater's shape. First of all, the crop changes according to the mask that we've drawn now, and the end result in both cases is quite good. There's a bit of a halo here that can be solved by lowering the blur in the mask, for example. But as you can see, the overall shape has been kept while the color has changed. And that's about it. Two very simple workflows. You can pick which one you want to use depending on whether or not you want higher quality in your inpaintings. And both of them extremely easy to use. And you could even automate it more by adding, for example, a segment anything node in order to always pick the sweater, for example, in case you want to automate this for a ton of images. Believe me, it has its uses. So that's gonna be all for today. Sorry for missing a few weeks. Life and work happened, and I didn't quite have the time to create new videos. I just started a new job as head of creative AI, and it took some time to settle into the new rhythm. But yeah, now that I am settled, I should be back to my normal schedule. So thank you for sticking with me. If you like this video, leave a like and subscribe. My name is Andrea Baioni. You can find me on Instagram at @reasonabushi or on the web at andreabaioni.com. And hopefully, same as, well, not always, but most of the time, I will be seeing you next week.